Welcome all of you to today's session. And now we are beginning with a case. The case, he is 32-year-old male patient Suresh. He comes to the casualty with severe watery diarrhea. Along with that, the patient has palpitation, giddiness, and patient falls in the casualty. And on detailed questioning, patient says that he has passed 20 motions in the day, all watery since morning, and accompanied with it, there were one or two episodes of vomiting. On examination, patient's pulse is around 110 per minute. The blood pressure is 90/70, and mouth and all mucosae are dried. The next day, 47 such cases of various age groups are admitted in the hospital with similar complaints. They all are of different grades of severity. What should be the line of management according to you? What should we do next? Clinically, any patient when come with diarrhea, then what do we suspect? And after one patient, if you have many patients coming to you with the similar complaints, then what do you suspect? When one patient, one single patient comes, it is say gastroenteritis. But when we have many such patients with the same complaints, then it means an outbreak. Okay. Now outbreak could be due to infection, or outbreak could be due to food poisoning. Let's go ahead. This is a classical case of cholera. Okay. And cholera is caused by organism called as Vibrio cholerae. Long questions which are asked in exam are: enumerate the organisms causing diarrhea, describe morphology, cultural characteristics, biochemical reactions, and lab diagnosis of Vibrio cholerae. Describe lab diagnosis of cholera with respect to, again, the same headings: microscopy, cultural characteristics, and biochemical test. So here all 6 marks are asked only for lab diagnosis, and there are 3 headings, so probably 2 to 2 marks is the division of marks. Then enumerate 4 bacteria causing diarrhea. Describe the role of cholera toxin in pathogenesis of cholera, and discuss the lab diagnosis. Okay, so 3 headings, you get 2 marks each. But in earlier questions, only lab diagnosis was to be written for 6 marks. And maybe in this question, you just have to write it for 2 marks. So accordingly, you have to tweak the answer. When lab diagnosis needs to be written only for 2 marks, that time, even if you write in a flowchart format, okay, that is acceptable. Where there, we just want to see the acumen, how you will proceed if you come across such patient. But when the lab diagnosis itself comes for 6 marks, then we are interested into everything, right from the diagram, morphology, up to the sensitivity testing, or even further advanced tests. Then there was a question on only lab diagnosis of cholera without giving any specific headings. I feel such questions are difficult to answer, because when you are given a split up, that time you know how much weightage to be given for each heading. When such blanket question comes, then according to each and every examiner's fancy, that question is given weightage, and accordingly the marks are awarded. Then discuss in detail pathogenesis and lab diagnosis of cholera. Then classify Vibrio and discuss lab diagnosis of cholera. Okay. Cholera is very frequently asked questions, at least alternate year. There is either a short note or long question, or some MCQ is asked on cholera. So remember to do this chapter very well. In short notes, there are a variety of questions asked. In the winter 2016 exam, there was this short note on Gardner and Venkatraman classification of Vibrio. Many a times the short note is asked on just classification of Vibrio. Then principles and uses of string test, cholera red test. This is a biochemical reaction specifically for cholera. Then there is a question on LTOR Vibrio. Then morphology and important growth requirements of Vibrio. Then differences between classical and LTOR biotype. Then mechanism of action of cholera toxin. Recently asked in 2019, summer 2019, is a short note on halophilic Vibrio. And similar short note asked in winter 2017, that's on Kanagawa phenomena. Okay, so lots of questions possible from this topic, and you can make permutations and combinations, and it can be also a question in long answer questions. So we move ahead and we try to understand the pathogenesis of Vibrio cholera. Does anybody has any idea what is a pathogenesis in case of cholera? What is the route of infection? What is the mechanism? Which is the key factor? What happens exactly when Vibrio enters through the contaminated food and water? If the food has bicarbonate ions and the pH of the food is little on alkaline side, it's even better because that causes neutralization of the gastric pH. Now, Vibrio is the organism which requires alkaline pH. It loves alkaline pH. If there is a lot of acidity, then the organism dies quickly. And hence, if the food is accompanied with the infected water, then the chances of survival of Vibrio are much higher because food neutralizes the acidity and it lets a Vibrio cholerae pass to jejunum. That is the site where jejunal epithelial cells is the site where Vibrio goes and acts. All right. So once it reaches the small intestine, it goes to the epithelial cell. And as we know that intestinal epithelium is covered with mucin, the enzyme which is secreted by Vibrio, it cleaves the mucin and the organism reaches up to the level of intestinal epithelium. It sits right on the top of intestinal epithelial cell. It causes a colonization and then starts secreting cholera toxin. Now, one quick question here is, does Vibrio enter inside the epithelial cell? Does it invade inside or it just remains superficially attached to the epithelial cell? What is the answer? Yes, very important. Okay. The Vibrio never invades inside. As you see in case of entero-invasive E. coli, or you see in case of Shigella, where the organism is associated with dysentery, or for that matter, Salmonella. All these organisms actually enter inside the epithelial cells and they invade inside. Vibrio does not have ability to invade inside, and that is why we don't get dysentery in case of cholera infection. It's always just diarrhea. Do you all know the difference between diarrhea and dysentery? The diarrhea is only loose stools, watery stools, whereas dysentery is when the stool is mixed with blood and mucus flakes, or even the leukocytes can be detected, then that is called as dysentery. Since Vibrio doesn't enter inside, only the cholera toxin which is secreted by Vibrio enters, it leads to diarrhea. Now this cholera toxin, like any other exotoxin, has A plus B structure. There are one single A unit that is called as active fragment and five binding subunits. Binding subunits, they go and bind to GM1 ganglioside receptors on the jejunal epithelial cell. The A subunit, which is the active subunit, it goes inside the epithelial cell. And there it is split into A1 plus A2. A2 is again a fragment which binds A1 to binding subunits. And A1 is real active part of the cholera toxin, and it causes activation of adenylate cyclase. Now, the role of adenylate cyclase is to increase the cyclic AMP. So, cyclic AMP levels in the epithelial cell, they go on rising. And with cyclic AMP on rise, the chloride ion get accumulated in the epithelial cell and they are thrown out of the intestinal epithelial cell into intestinal lumen. Now, as chloride ion go out, along with that, the water molecule also travel outside, which is ultimately thrown out of the human body, and that's how patient gets a watery diarrhea. Let's see this in the diagram. Can you see this? This is a Vibrio. Vibrio is coming in the gut. And this green you see is the cholera toxin, which is secreted by Vibrio. Vibrio remains in the lumen. And the toxin goes inside. A part is split into A1 and A2. A1 causes outpouring, increased cyclic AMP. And the chloride ions along with the water is thrown out of the lumen. Watch it once again. Vibrio comes. Toxin, it binds to GM1 ganglioside receptors here. Only A goes inside. This AC is adenylate cyclase. A1 splits, causes rise in cyclic AMP. Did you understand?